Newest addition to the NewsHour bookshelf. It is a different take on the Civil War era. ABC News and NPR political commentator Cokie Roberts' latest book is Capital Dames, The Civil War and the Women of Washington, 1848 through 1868. Earlier this week, Gwen sat down and talked with Cokie at Busboys and Poets here in the D.C. area.
Cokie, thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
This book, Capital Dames, is so interesting to me because while we've been talking about the Civil War and the heroes of the Civil War, we know all these names, but we never hear women's names, and you've gone back and found them.
Well, that's pretty much true throughout our history. I mean, one of the reasons I've been writing books about women in history is because other people haven't been, and telling history without talking about one half of the human race seems to me to be an inaccurate way of telling the story.
Some of the women you talk about in this book, we've vaguely heard of. We kind of know who Clara Barton was. Some women we've never heard of at all. Who are your favorites? Who surprised you that you discovered?
Well, one that just totally cracked me up was Abigail Brooks Adams, the wife of Charles Francis Adams, who was John Quincy Adams' son. And he was in Congress for a term, but it was the term when the South seceded. And he then went to be the Union ambassador to England and kept England from siding with the South. But she, in the tradition of her grandmother-in-law and mother-in-law, was this outspoken Yankee woman. And she would write home these letters that have never been published before about how President Buchanan is a toad, and one of her husband's colleagues in the delegation was a pig. And she's writing these to Henry Adams, who became famous, of course, in his own right. And then she has one wonderful letter where she says, if any young woman wants to have a nice, quiet life, I advise her not to marry an Adams.
Which is true. But a lot of these women, their surnames are the wives of famous women, except one interesting one who's the niece of a famous man. President Buchanan's niece was the First Lady.
She was, and she was actually the first person referred to as First Lady in the press, Harriet Lane. And she had lived with him since she was a little girl. Her parents had died. And she had gotten to know the ways of Washington when he had been in the cabinet. And then she went with him to England when he was ambassador to the court of St. James and became a great favorite of Queen Victoria. And we recently had a visit of the Prince of Wales. Well, the Prince of Wales came when she was in the White House, and all the newspaper accounts said that when he went to Mount Vernon and they showed him the key to the Bastille, he was actually more interested in looking at Miss Lane.
Verena Davis.
I think she's one of the most interesting people in the book.
Tell
I
us
really
about
like her.
Her
a lot. She is Jefferson Davis's wife. And she was always wildly skeptical of the Confederacy as a concept, knew that it could never really succeed. She also was very outspoken in her views when one of the belles, as they described themselves, of Washington, Adele Cutts, who was Dolly Madison's great niece, married Stephen Douglas. Verena Davis writes this letter home to her mother and says, "It's horrible. He stinks. He smells bad." And
Stephen Douglas, of course, was of the famous Lincoln. Douglas
absolutely.
Debates.
He beat Lincoln for the Senate and then ran for the presidency himself against Lincoln and two others. But then after the war was over, and she and Jefferson Davis had a somewhat fraught relationship. And she had a fraught relationship with the South. Among other things, her grandfather was a governor of New Jersey, and she was somewhat olive-complected. She wasn't fair enough for a perfect Southern belle.
And she ended up moving to New York after
so
the war.
When she moved to New York, everybody in the South had a fit. The First Lady of the Confederacy going to New York. And she wrote to her daughter and said, "I am free, brown, and 64. I could go wherever I want." But then when she got to New York, she befriended Julia Grant, the wife of Ulysses S. Grant. And that was one of the things I found very interesting. These women affected reconciliation in a variety of ways.
With each other, even though they were on other sides of the battle.
But they understood that it was symbolic for the nation. So she went went to the dedication of the Grant Memorial and knew that would be written about in all of the newspapers.
A lot of these women, you described them, and they described themselves as belles. They
right.
were social
right.
beings.
And yet, political.
But that's my point. They were also political in ways that probably the naked common eye wouldn't have noticed.
They were deeply political, very involved in their husbands' careers or fathers or brothers, went to the debates in Congress all the time, helped their husbands with speeches and letters and all of that, and had their views. And sometimes they weren't exactly the same as the men's.
And how did you discover all of this? Because it's one thing to know it or to see the one line in a history book. It's another thing to hear in these women's own words or in the words of female reporters a lot of
right,
the time,
right.
the way that this all unfolded.
Well, you go searching for letters among the men's letters. A few of them have letters that have been published in books, thank God, because that means they're actually transcribed. But then you beg historic societies or university libraries, who are actually quite cooperative now, to find what they can find. And with modern technology, they will scan these handwritten letters and send them to you. And then the challenge is being able to read them. And I had some help with that.
Well, I'm going to talk to you some more online about another woman you profile in this book, Elizabeth Keckley, who I thought was really important and
very
interesting.
Important.
But she from a different point of view. We'll talk about that online. Cokie Roberts, thank you very much.
Thank you, Gwen.